Good evening. Thank you for joining us this evening as I welcome Father Garvin from the Mustard Seed Community, the Executive Director. We're also being live streamed, so to speak, so I welcome the families of the Heights High School who are tuning in, as well as the families from Radford University. One group is currently down there, and one group is going next week. And this will form as an introduction to the beautiful ministry of Mustard Seed Communities. This evening and tomorrow night and on Wednesday, Father will be preaching and sharing with us this gift, this grace that God has given to us in this year of mercy and bestowing grace upon us following the talk this evening. Father Bill and I will be happy to hear confessions this evening. So it's a pleasure to welcome Father Garvin tonight as he opens our hearts to the great responsibility of mercy and sharing mercy with others.
May I please invite you to stand for a moment? And those of you who feel so inclined to join me in singing, just set the tone. We'll sing "Lord, Prepare Me." Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, your and holy. the Father's immense and intense love for us. Swallowing up your property, he and his loose woman, you kill the calf we have been fattening. The father said, my son, you are with me always, and all I have is yours. But it was only right we should celebrate and rejoice, because your brother here was dead. the book, Pope Francis's recent book, The Name of God is Mercy. God came not to help, but to show us mercy. Why? Because of this. Coming from the Father. A tremendous act of mercy that actually has nothing to do with forgiveness. Two independent graces. Sometimes we all confuse mercy and forgiveness. Yes, one can flow from the other, but they're different. The Father showed a tremendous sense of mercy towards the Son, independent, even before he thought about forgiveness. The Father was waiting patiently, lovingly, anticipating the Son's return. He didn't seem to care one way or the other what the boy had to say. From the distance he saw him coming, and immediately he began to get super excited about the boy coming back home. Let's have a feast. Let's get out the wine, the beautiful red wine. Let's kill the fatted calf. Let's have a celebration. Nothing about forgiveness. Pure mercy. Why? Because the boy is coming home. This is not normal. This is not a normal reaction. Because in today's world, in any situation, the normal thing to do would first be an explanation. Why did you do what you did? We would want the boy to explain, to admit that he did something wrong, to ask for sorrow. And then the boy would probably have to say, "Please, sir, forgive me." That's normal. And then, and only then, we who have been wronged may consider forgiveness. What can we learn about God from this passage, from this parable of the Father's reaction to the Son? God's ways are not man's ways, God's thoughts are not man's thoughts. God's logic is not man's logic. We learn that what we think is normal, what we consider normal, is not normal to God. Because his ways and his thoughts are different from ours. We learn that our understanding of mercy falls far short of God's outpouring of immense and intense mercy. We learn that we have a lot to learn. Pope Francis asked us at the beginning of Lent not to waste Lent. He said, "Don't waste Lent." I would like to repeat those words in the sense that we have to use this time to search within ourselves, to go out into the desert of our lives and search within ourselves how we are responding to the Father's mercy. Those moments in our lives when we, like the son, went and squandered the generosity, the goodness. That image of the Father standing there, waiting, anticipating the son's return, is a very powerful and humbling image, because that's the image that God, that we ought to have of God waiting for us, waiting, yearning for us. And on top of that, God is going to celebrate our return. So it's illogical. It doesn't make sense. That in spite of our wrongdoings, in spite of our failings, God still stands there waiting, waiting for that celebration. I want to share a little bit about my own journey. There's a song that comes to mind that I don't know if you want to. I like singing, by the way, in case you didn't know. That image of the Father waiting for the Son, looking out for the Son, is that image I have of God waiting for me, looking for me, anticipating my return. I don't know if you know that it's Gregory Norbert, come back to me. Come back to me with all your heart. Don't let fear keep us apart. I started to know. Let me start. Come back to me with all your heart. Don't let fear keep us apart. Trees to bend, though straight and tall, so must we to others fall. Long have I waited for your home to me and living deeply on your land. The wilderness will lead you to your heart, where I will speak integrity and justice with tenderness.
So
I was ordained a priest 5 years ago. So I'm now 52 years old, so we can do the math. I'm a late vocation. It is a very long journey to this point. I remember growing up in a very Catholic family, traditional Catholic family, which I'm so many of you are familiar with. My mother took us to Mass every Sunday, and during the week, if we could manage that, we prayed the rosary every evening when we finished our homework. She wouldn't allow us to go to bed without praying the rosary. We attended retreats and pilgrimages and all sorts of devotions in our early years. Yes, I grew up in a very Catholic family. In fact, I have two brothers who are priests. Up to today, I was sharing earlier, up to today, my mother, who is 94 years old, gets up at 3 o'clock in the morning to pray. I don't think I can do that. So my foundation was solid. Very important for all of us, for those of us who are children. A solid foundation is vital. Then in the decade of my 20s, as I will refer to it as, things started to go wrong. I stopped going to Mass. I have friends who were fond of drinking and partying and smoking and doing all sorts of things that young people do. I remember there were Sunday mornings when my mother would call me. As she got older, she would call me to take her to church. And I would get her from my bed in my drunkenness, jump in the car, drive her to church, 6 o'clock Mass. And she would say, "You're coming in?" And I said, "Yeah, yeah, I'm coming. You just go on and come in." And I would park the car and sleep in the car until Mass was over. I had a good job. I traveled. I did all the normal things that people would do. I bought the stereo and the Walkman and the cable TV and the new car and all the material things and more. The decade of my 20s. But the one thing that I could never find was true happiness and peace. Because the more I partied, and the more I drank, and the more I bought gadgets and things, empty life. And I remember those nights when my mother would be waiting at the window, 2 o'clock in the morning, to see me get home. And about the third day, something happened. I'm up on this ladder, painting, kind of being hanging on the ladder. No protective gear or anything, just on the two-story building. And I remember clearly it was November because Christmas was coming. And with the lovely voice that I have, I like to sing. So I was singing Christmas carols up on this ladder, painting. And I'm singing these Christmas carols and I'm painting, trying to pass the time, get it over with, you know. And then suddenly I looked around beneath me, and there was a whole circle of children looking up at me. Beautiful children with disabilities, Down syndrome, hydrocephalic, all sorts of various, and they're all just looking at me in awe, singing by myself on this ladder. That was my first Eureka moment. God, in his love and mercy, was looking at me through the eyes of those children. And something happened at that point in my life, this was in 1996, that said to me, "You fool, come home, come back to me. This is what it's about. It is not about who I am and what I can do and the talent I have and the gifts I have." That's a mistake we make. That's a mistake we make when we think it's all about me. It's all about what I can do. No. Yes, we have to examine ourselves, we have to look at ourselves, but in the context of the bigger picture. Each one of us has a part to play in this bigger picture of life, in God's plan. We have to get down, we have to be humbled. That's what happened at that moment in my life. Here I was, a successful man who was whatever, you know, could do all this. Somehow, on the faces of those children, God really had a sense of humor, you know. On the faces of those children, he said to me, "Come back. Come back." That was November of 1996. I often tell people, I left Trinidad and went to Jamaica on a vacation, and it turned into a vocation because I never went back to Trinidad. From that moment until 5 years later, 2001, I never went back. I stayed because something happened. Because I recognized God's mercy. Because in spite of my sinfulness, in spite of all that I had done in the decade of my 20s, in spite of all the people that I hurt, God's mercy? Do we understand? the tremendous, intense mercy that God has for us. It doesn't matter. I learned it really does not matter how bad we think we are. It really doesn't matter what we have done. What matters is finding it, recognizing His presence, recognizing His mercy in our daily lives. Because as we will talk about tomorrow, in that recognition of His mercy, it leads to something else. But we have to recognize it, we have to see it. And too often, we stifle ourselves, we entrap ourselves in our sinfulness. And we forever think we are unworthy. Yes, we know I'm unworthy. We are all unworthy. But God's immense and intense love and mercy for us, because of who God is, will always bring us home, rejoicing and celebrating. So I continued my journey as a lay volunteer with Mustard Seed Communities in Jamaica, looking after children with disabilities, HIV and AIDS. I thought, okay, I can do this for a while. Then I remember, well, along that way, I remember the Archbishop asking me time and time again, you know, why don't you become a priest? Why don't you, you know, give your life over totally to yourself again? And I'll do this for a while and then go back to my construction work or whatever. Again, there's so much I can say. So, in 2002, I went to Africa. And there are a couple of experiences there which really sort of seal the deal, if you want to call it that. I remember one occasion, so I'm in Africa, in Zimbabwe, and I don't know how much you know about that situation there. It's a very politically tense situation. And I'm starting Mustard Seed Communities, looking after children who are orphans, feeding programs, etc. And one day, at about 6:30 in the evening, the police come to arrest me. This is in 2003. I went there in 2002, so about a year later. And it was really, really a grueling, frustrating experience being there. There are many times I felt like giving up. But I said, okay, I'm going to do this. And then this day came. There I was in our house. We had a little house. And there were about 30, 35 young people who were with me, young African boys and girls. They were part of my little group that was helping to feed the children and so on. And this Wednesday evening, we were praying the rosary, as, you know, again, I'm back home. So we have to pray the rosary every day, every evening, can't get it out of my system. So we pray the rosary, and the police come to arrest me. There are these two well-dressed guys in suits. So I said, okay, whatever, I don't know. But what was strange was that a lot of the young people started to cry. I said, I want to stop crying. I'll be back shortly. So I go with the police to where they were taking me. We get to this building. By this time it's about 7, so it's dark. They take me upstairs, and then I started to worry because the strange thing was there were no lights in the building. It's totally dark. So they take me up these stairs, down this corridor, and put me in this room to sit. And I sat. And I sat. And I sat. And then when I couldn't take it anymore, because I couldn't see a thing, pitch black. So I reached into my pocket, and I pulled out my rosary that I always carried with me, and I started to pray. At about 9:30, 10 o'clock, the two officers come back. They ask me a couple of silly questions, and they let me go. But the amazing part of this experience is that when I got back to the house, this is after 10 o'clock at night, the young people that I left there were still there, and they were still praying. They were still praying. And they told me the reason that they were crying when I was leaving is because this particular branch of the police, when they take you, you don't come back. So when they saw this particular branch of the police come to arrest me, they thought they would never see me again. But God is in charge. If we are doing God's work, if we commit ourselves to God in whatever capacity, God is in charge. Not to mention Mother Mary, who's always there. Ever faithful, watching over us. But again, for me, that was another moment of God's tremendous mercy on someone who still was wavering. You know, you're doing it, but you're not sure. I'll share one more story with you. It was actually the nail in the coffin, so to speak. 2006, April. Again, in Zimbabwe, I'm driving. Again, this is a long story, but I'll make it. I'll shorten it a little bit. So at the time, the economic situation was so bad that the currency was so devalued, you had to carry lots and lots of money around. Lots of money. So a loaf of bread was $1 million, you know, the useless currency. But to get by, you had to do things that were not necessarily lawful by their standards. Because there was a law in the country that no one person could have more than $100 at any one time, the equivalent of $100. And we were at the time building our orphanage and feeding children, so we were spending probably $10,000-$15,000 a month. And we had to find ways to get that money into the country. So it's a long story. So this one particular day, I am driving from where we are to a transfer point to meet someone who I'm giving $10,000 to get the equivalent in their local currency. make this 6-hour journey, meet the man, hand over the money, and he hands over the local currency. What I did not bargain for, what I didn't calculate, was that the equivalent of $10,000 was a truckload of money. So there were boxes and boxes and boxes of cash that I had to carry back. So we load this money into my pickup truck and all into the back seat. Boxes. I mean, this is ridiculous sums of money. Useless currency. But on the journey back, I forgot that we crossed a major police roadblock coming to this location that I had to go back through. So we're driving to the roadblock, and it's down in the distance. And I see the police in the distance, and I immediately said something that I cannot say here. Everything flashed before me. The law says $100 equivalent. I have the equivalent of $10,000. There's a guy in the car next to me, two of us. His name is Barry. So Barry starts to sweat. So he says, "Stop the car, stop the car." I said, "I can't stop. They're seeing us." He said, "Well, turn around." I said, "I can't turn around. They're seeing us." And I'm driving slowly. And the roadblock is there, and the policeman is sort of waving me to stop. Guess what? I dip it in my pocket, and I take out my rosary, and I said, "Barry, let's pray." There's nothing else to do at this point. Let's pray. So I start. And we're getting closer and closer to the roadblock. And as we're about to stop, this is no joke. It's funny, but it's not a joke. As we're about to stop, a car comes in the opposite direction, crashes through the roadblock, skitters everything and everyone. And we drive straight through. Amen, I say to you. I just said, "God, I'm done. You have me." That for me was the final nail in the coffin. That was the moment when I was truly convinced that this is what I had to do. That was the moment when God said, "It's not about you. It's not about you. I just want you to do this." That was the moment when His tremendous love and mercy hit me like a ton of bricks. I called my archbishop the next day and I said, "This is it. I'm done." The joy and fulfillment, the peace that I experience now having let go of myself, having given myself in the service of, the joy and fulfillment I experience when you look at the faces of those children in Jamaica and Nicaragua and Zimbabwe. Nothing can replace that. That joy and fulfillment is as a result of God's mercy. I think of a passage from Peter, from I've lost all my notes. From Luke. That passage where Jesus went out of the boat and told Simon Peter, throw your net on the other side, and Simon Peter said, you are a carpenter. What do you know? I'm a fisherman. But I'll do it anyway, just to show you. And he pulls out a catch of fish that is so great. Simon Peter falls to his knees and says, leave me, I'm a sinful man. And Jesus said, no. But I will make you a fisher of men. It doesn't matter what we think we know. What matters is allowing God to enter our lives, take hold of it, transform it, and use us for that purpose for which we were created. Pope Francis said in the book, The Name of God is Mercy, he says, the Lord receives us, he anticipates us. His divine mercy, which heals our wounds, he anticipates our need for it. God waits. God waits for us to concede him only the smallest glimmer of space. God waits for the smallest glimmer of space to show us his immense and intense love and mercy. My dear brothers and sisters, today let us think about how God's mercy has impacted our lives. I only shared my story with you to show you that I'm one of you. We're all together in this. We're no different. We have different roles in this journey, but we're no different. And once we start to accept that, accept that we're all sinners, and we're all being invited to come home, to come back. Let us reflect, let's use the prodigal son passage. And there's so much that can be said about that passage. But let us just look at the son's reaction of turning back and the father's reaction of celebrating. And let us see how in each of our lives we probably need, in one way or another, to turn back. This Lenten period
reflection.
Where and how do I need to return home so that the Father who is waiting for me, who is anticipating me, can rejoice and celebrate and say, here's my child who was dead and is now alive, who was lost and is now found. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
For coming out this evening. Tomorrow night, Father will be here. Currently, right now, Father Bill and I will be happy to hear confessions. We thank you for your support. Father Garvin will be in the back of the church to greet you. God bless you. Thank you for supporting our mission tonight.
Thank you.